Mark chapter 10, verses 17 to 22. Praise the Lord. I will read. As Jesus started on his journey, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus asked. "No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." "Teacher," he declared, "all these I have kept since I was a boy." Jesus looked at him and bowed him. "One thing you lack," he said. "Go, sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me." At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he was a man of great wealth. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God." Amen. Praise the Lord. ഉറുദു മലയാളത്തിൽ മർക്കോസ് സുവിശേഷം പത്താം അധ്യായത്തിൻ്റെ 17 മുതൽ 22 ഉള്ള വാക്യം ദയവായി നിങ്ങൾ വായിക്കും. പ്രൈസ് ദി ലോർഡ്. ദിസ് ഈസ് നോട്ട് റിട്ടൺ ഇൻ മാർക്ക് അലോൺ. ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് ഓൾസോ റിട്ടൺ ഇൻ മാത്യു ആൻഡ് ലൂക്ക്. മാത്യു ചാപ്റ്റർ 19 വേഴ്സസ് 16 to 30 ആൻഡ് ഗോസ്പിൾ ഓഫ് ലൂക്ക് 18 to 30. Praise the Lord. Over here in Matthew, there is a variation. He had added, he added another phrase. If you want to be perfect, the man was asking for eternal life. And he asked, "What should I do to inherit eternal life?" Then the Lord in Matthew was there with him when this incident occurred. When this man ran up to him and fell at his feet, called him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" That was his question. And this man is said to be a very, very rich man. He is also said to be a ruler. He also is stated to be an young man. And then we read that he ran and fell at the Lord, at the feet of Jesus. These things might open our eyes. Let us look at this gentleman who ran to Jesus. He was an young man, just like you and me. He was rich. And he says he had kept, or he has been keeping, he has kept all the commandments ever since he was a boy. According to him, and all those people standing around him, he is a flawless man. There is nothing wrong with his life. So the reputation he has is one of the best youth in the community. The rich man is standing before the Lord, and nobody is disputing. Not even the Lord who searches our hearts. He did not dispute that he didn't keep any of the commandments. He only saw how many things he had come short. One day. The Lord said, there is something wrong, even though you have kept everything. And even though there is a lot of lovable things in your life, because the Lord looked at him. And we read that the Lord loved him. This morning when I was watching, I was looking at Jason. I looked at him. And then I noticed something wrong. By looking at his face, I see him every week. I looked at him again. And he gave me a smile. Then I looked at him again and I laid my hands upon him. I loved him. Because I knew that he was sick, and then I asked his father. Pastor Joe's father said he is keeping a cough and everything associated with that, right? He is sick, so what you need to do is pray. What my point is, the Lord looked at him. You need to look at that particular scene. There is a picture in there. The Lord has started on a journey from a place where he had laid his hands on children and blessed them and told his disciples, you don't stop children coming to me because I love the children. I want them to come forward. Whatever I do, wherever I am, how busy I am, I want the children to come to forward and meet with me because I want to bless them. And he said, he always said, unless you turn your life around and become like children, you will not even go to heaven. So their children are very, very close to heaven, according to the Lord, right? Even if they are running around, don't mind. The Lord has kept them very, very near to his heart. It is more than the parents love the children. That lesson is taught to me by my wife. I always look at things and say, hey, if you put it over there, it's likely to fall. And then I look around and see something wrong. I say, hey, that's something wrong. But then think about children. I used to tell her, hey, it can go wrong over here and over there. And then she taught me, it is not we who keep the children. It is the Lord who watches over the children. And then she asked, hey, when they go to school, are you there to watch over them? No, the Lord is there to watch over their every step. Every moment they are growing, the Lord is watching over them. So the Lord loves the children. That is what the Lord was teaching before he set on the journey from a place. And then he was dealing with the children. He was blessing the children. He was talking about the children. He was loving the children. It was a busy occasion, and then he set out on a journey. He wanted to go somewhere else and preach. Days before, he was in Capernaum. And then he was everywhere in Galilee. And he did not have time to take rest. He was on a busy journey, always set out to preach, like the Lord's servant said, everywhere in North India, he goes and preaches. Seeing this, there was a young man, just like every young man over here. He ran to the Lord. What does it tell you? This man did not feel ashamed of running to the Lord, even though there was no one to run with. And look at his reputation. He is the ruler. He is a young man. He is a ruler. He is a very, very rich person. He did not look at his reputation like, I'm a rich person. I shouldn't be running to this lowly Lord. No rich people was enthusiastic to welcome the Lord in those days. And no Pharisees was going after the Lord, even though they asked questions to trap him. Why did I say? This man is asking the Lord a question which only the Pharisee will ask. That question is, what should I do to inherit eternal life? You need to know Sadducees were the other group of people opposed to the Lord Jesus, and they followed him to trap him with questions. And this man is not trying to trap the Lord with a question. Rather, he wants to know about the eternal life, life after death. That only was the way the Pharisees believed. Only Pharisees believed. The Sadducees were against them. You remember once Paul wanted to get away from a riot, and then he stood up and said, oh, my dear brethren, I'm in trial because of my belief in life after death. The Sadducees were against life after death. And the Pharisees and Sadducees got together, and there was a big riot broke out. So only Pharisees were after eternal life. He was not a Sadducee. Sadducean life, Pharisee. He was very close to the Lord. He ran to the Lord. He did not look around who is going with him and who is standing around him, who is looking at him with a disdainful look. Disdainful look is a look with a disgrace. He did not pay attention to that. He probably was a rich man in that area. He has a good reputation. His reputation is he has lived a flawless life. And he says, I kept all the commandments ever since I was a boy in the community. He was having a good reputation, but he did not pay attention to those things. He ran to the Lord, fell at his feet. He respected the Lord as a good teacher. He respected the Lord as a good teacher. He recognized the Lord is of somebody. He recognized he can teach. He probably even said, probably he will say, he was a great man. He can teach, he had some authority. So he ran to him. And next thing that we see is falling prostrate at his feet. He knelt down. And then he stood up and said, Lord, good teacher, what should I do to inherit eternal life? And the Lord said, you need to keep all, you know very well that you need to keep all the commandments. And then he said, Lord, what are the commandments? He said, do not kill, do not lie, do not defraud, do not say false testimony. And all these things he said, everything he said was his relationship with the other man. But the Lord did not touch any part of the Ten Commandments that deals with our relationship with God. The man had a good reputation among men. And he was keeping all those commandments in good relationship with his peers or his friends. But when he was having a good reputation, good relationship in the society with people, he was lacking the major, the most important relationship, that was with the Lord, and the Lord did not mention any of those commandments at all. And he is looking at us this morning. Many of you are young people. You have good reputation in your society, and that reputation you think you have is because of your relationship and your good standing among the people of the society, but that at the same time we are on a journey to seeking after the eternal life. And we don't know what is standing in between we, every one of us, and the eternal life. And we don't know what exactly is. Actually, that statement is wrong. If there is something wrong in my life, it is me who knows about that first. And secondly, it is the Almighty God who knows. Praise the Lord. We cannot hide anything from the Lord, and we cannot hide anything from our own life. So he knew what was wrong in his life, but still he wanted to know, is there anything that he needs to do further to have eternal life? The Lord looked at him. He loved him. He had compassion on his pathetic situation. It is not a love that he was going to go straight to heaven. It was the look at the Lord, that the Lord gave him, as though he was the person who was talking to Jacob from the top of the ladder. Jacob was lying over there in Luz, keeping a stone as his pillow, and there was an angel of the Lord going and coming to the heavens and coming down, and the Lord spoke to him from the top of the ladder. And that was not because the Lord approved his life. Rather, he had some compassion on him about his life. That compassion ran all through Jacob's life. Sometimes the Lord speaks to us. The Lord sees us. The Lord knows all about us. He reads every thought that is in our hearts. He knows every desire we have, every step in our lives. And still, he will have some love to us. What is that love? The Lord loves every sinner. He hates sin, but he loves every sinner. He loves the whole world. How much? So much that he gave his only begotten Son. He loves us so much even if we are not right with the Lord. And he saw this man, and when he fell at his feet and called him good father, he asked one question: why do you call me good? There is only one person good, that is God. Why? Why did he say that? Because this gentleman who was falling, who fell at the feet of the Lord, was hesitating to call Jesus as his God and Savior and the Lord. He knew Jesus only as a good teacher. There is something that I can follow Jesus. There is something that Jesus has that this young man could follow Jesus, but he did not see the person that standing before him was the right person who can give him eternal life. Jesus, if he believed Jesus as his Lord, accepted him as his Lord and Savior, the next step he was taking was to enter into the kingdom of God. Eternal life was just one step away from this man. He was standing right before the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the person who holds eternity in him, the one person who has existence by himself. He alone has existence. Everything else exists in him or because of him. The Lord Jesus is the only one who has existence, self-existence. We none of us have a self-existence. We all exist because God exists. We all exist in God. Without God, there is no existence. We are here because of the Lord. And the Lord is standing before him in person. And he is talking to the Lord, asking him, what should I do to obtain or to receive eternal life? The Lord had pity on him. That is why he looked at him. He reads every thought in his life. He was a man who desired eternal life. He was a man who had recognized the Lord as a good teacher. He did not recognize him as his Lord. And he did not accept him into his life. He was not willing to give away everything that he was holding dear to his heart for the cause of the Lord. There was a lot of things that he was holding very dear to his heart. The things of the world. When the Lord says, do not love the world and what else? Anything? Those things that are in the world. This man was holding the world close to his heart. And he was loving everything in this world. He could not give away everything for the Lord. He wanted the treasure, but he was not willing to sell all his possessions. So he was not a serious person. So what happened? He was just one step away, just one word away from eternal life. He was close. He was like the man who was sitting at the gate of beautiful Sundaravana Govindathinte enna govindathinte vaadikal irunna vichakkarane pole oru step avan agaleyai. But he was not willing to step in. About the beggar, he was unable to step in. This man was able to step in. He showed a lot of respect for the Lord. He was a man of worship. He was a religious man. He was worshipping the Lord every week because he kept all the commandments. And he was a man of good reputation. He did not have any flaw according to him. But then, don't look at the children. I accept it. Praise the Lord. As long as he doesn't turn that out, don't pay attention. Our issue is, what was wrong with this person? He was unwilling. He was unwilling to accept the Lord in wholehearted. Partial acceptance was there. He wanted to follow Jesus if it was possible. But the Lord demanded something else. He had to sell everything that belonged to him in this world. And it says, because he was a very, very rich person, he became very sad. First thing that happened was his face fell. Vadi. And then he went away. How sad. And the Lord looked at him with a pathetic look. And he said, it is very, very difficult for a person who is very rich in this world to enter into the kingdom of God. Is it about the rich man that is talking about? It is about every one of us. We are all standing at the gate of heaven. We have received the Lord. We have been worshipping the Lord for long. We can say I have a good reputation with the Lord and the kingdom of the Lord and everything in the temple of the Lord. But the Lord looks at you and me and finds a single thing as a fault. What is that single thing? That is the most important thing in your life and mine that the Lord doesn't have in any place in your life. You are a moral man. You are a man who is going to the church. Read the Bible. And you show a lot of things that lot of show you have in the temple. But the Lord says he doesn't have a place for the Lord in his heart. He loves the things of the world. And he loves the world, the pleasures of the world. He loves the pleasures for the world. He loves those gains that the pastor was talking about and laughing. When prayer is going, everyone who is using telephone is not playing games. Don't give that idea. But he did not have a place for the Lord in his heart. But what did the people say? This man is a man of God. He had a good upbringing. From childhood onwards, he was in the church. But when the Lord met him face to face, he said, as you think, everything is not right with you. I see there is one thing that is wrong, that you don't have the Lord in your heart and life, and you need to come back and change. He said, you need to sell everything, you need to discard, give away and give up every attachment that is holding you back from me. Everything that is holding you back from the Lord said that you need to give away them. It is not because you have the riches were sinful. If the riches were holding him back, because the Bible says he was a very, very rich man. He could not give them up. Can I ask you a question? What is the one thing that is holding you back? What did the Lord say? There is one thing that is lacking in your life. What is the one thing that is keeping you away from praying to the Lord? What is the one thing that is keeping you away for a complete and full commitment to the Lord? What is holding you back? What is pulling you backward to the world so that you will not fly into the heaven? You and I have to find out what is gravitating on our spiritual life, pulling us down, so that we will not go to eternal life. He came asking, what should I do? Whatever you want me to do, I will do. But when the most important thing was pointed out, the man became very, very sad. When the Lord points to our heart, finds fault with our life. While I am preaching, if you will point out, hey, pastor, hey, this is what I heard or saw, you will see, hey, he is okay. She's okay. If you say, you will see my face falling down because you are pointing at me. Over there, the Lord was pointing at him, saying that even though you think you are all right, I see one thing that is lacking in your life. You don't have a place for the Lord in your heart. You are a person who is not willing to give away the attachments for you in this world that is holding on to you. I have seen a lot of people like that. I have seen a lot of people like that. So many things that is holding near to our hearts, which they will say, I am not coming to the church, or I'm not worshiping the Lord, I'm not taking baptism, I'm not accepting the Lord, because I cannot give up these things. And the Lord is pointing at you and at me. And then he went away sad. He went away sad. And this is the only person who came to the Lord ever and became sad. And this is about the rich man, right? You believe, right? The child is there. I'll even lift her and put it on my shoulders and preach. As you left her, she's okay. If you ever will not give up what is not acceptable to the Lord, that is going to make you very sad.
Amen.
That is going to make the Lord
very
disappointed about
you. Yes.
But if you will give up and then come and follow the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
How to follow Jesus?
Yes.
Come and take up the cross.
And follow
whatever shame, whatever tough things that you have to face in this world, you have to be willing to take them upon the Lord, upon you, and then keep following the Lord. The Lord was asking him to come and follow him, have a journey with the Lord all through his life. He was asking the Lord, the Lord was asking him to start a journey with the Lord. Not only you give up things, but you keep walking with the Lord. Keep walking with the Lord. Have a continuous fellowship with the Lord. Keep looking at the Lord. Keep listening to the Lord. Having fellowship. What kind of fellowship? Unbroken fellowship. A fellowship that has no break in between.
Amen.
Wherever he wants you to go, you will go. Whatever he wants you to do, you will do. More than that, the one thing that you have in your life, whatever you have to give away, you have to give up, and that will make you just step into the kingdom of God. But this man was not willing to do so. My dear beloved children of God, this morning I beseech with you, I plead with you,
amen,
to think about that one thing,
yes,
that is holding you back.
Yes, hallelujah.
That one thing that is pulling you back. Anything that standing in between you and the Lord. You need to give up. You need to push aside. And you need to start a journey. He said, go and celebrate. Give to the poor.
Hallelujah.
And come and follow. And that following has the notion of taking up your cross and following him daily.
Amen.
Following him
daily.
Daily. All through your life. Actually believe. The word believe has a meaning. That you accept the Lord. With a higher standard, you rise up from your lower standards to a higher level with a higher vision of the Lord and Christian life. Not you need to see Christian life at a higher level. Those things that you were doing yesterday, you should say, I will not do them. Those things that the Lord will not approve, even though they are very tasty and pleasing and dearly, I love them dearly, you have to give them up. If you don't give them up, what is going to happen is next moment, you yourself will feel that you are going to feel sad, your face will fall, and you will go, and nobody is going to go with you. And that walk away from Jesus was the walk away from what he was seeking, the eternal
life.
He was walking away from Jesus, and he was walking away from
eternal life.
Heaven. What did he want in the first place? To go to heaven. That same thing. He was walking away. He did not want it to happen.
Hallelujah. So
praise the Lord. How many of you will surrender your lives to the Lord?
Amen.
How many of you will say, Lord, hereafter I will walk with you. Lord, whatever is holding me back, I will discard. I will take it away and throw it away. Lord, I will not look back. I will not look on my side. Who is running with me to the Lord? There was no one to run to the Lord with this rich man. He alone ran. He was not ashamed of going and calling him and falling at his feet when everyone was opposed to him. He was a dedicated man. But then, when the Lord points it to his heart, when he points to my heart, son, you have to do this. I must be willing to do that. Let us bow our heads. Let's talk to ourselves first. Let us look into our hearts. What is holding me back from Jesus? That one thing that the Lord doesn't approve in my life. What am I doing and what am I planning to do in my future, which the Lord may not approve? What is the path that I should follow? The only path I should follow is to take Jesus into my heart as my Lord and Savior and start a journey with an unbroken fellowship from today onwards till the last moment. That is why the Lord said, I will be with you till the end of the age. Amen. So you cannot break it before that.
Yes.
How many days the Lord has given you? You need to continue this walk. Amen. Praise the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you and we bless you. Lord, we give you all glory and honor and praise. And we thank you for teaching us a lesson. That even though we think we are close to eternity, and you see there is one thing that is holding us back. Thank you for pointing out that particular point that is holding us and pulling us away from you. Help us, Lord, to throw away and discard all those things and cut all those ties and take everything from our hearts and place you in our hearts, Lord, our Savior, Lord and Savior, and follow you through out our lives, Lord, taking our cross and blessing your name, walking with you in an unbroken fellowship, praising your name, giving you glory, Lord, in everything that we do and we plan to do. Father, we pray that you help us and lay your hands upon each one of us, especially on our youth. Bless every one of us, O Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. Yeah.